I've been here 2 years, almost 2 years next week. And so, you know, our staff meetings are a little interesting. So, you know, Pat and Winnie have been here a decade. Ben and Lauren have been here a decade. And so I, like, you know, I'm the new guy, and I understand that. If I'm going to say something, it needs to be incredibly valuable because they've been here a decade. Like, they have inside jokes that I don't get. They talk about people, and I'm like, I don't know who that is. And so, they're always talking about, you know, someone else. And so, you know, recently I was super offended. I was super triggered. And, you know, I go onto the app, and I'm just kind of exploring it. And I look at our staff page, and this is what our staff page looks like. Like, okay. I understand, like, all of these people have been here a super long time. Like, okay. Like, all right. I think that's pretty awesome. I actually was going to make, like, a giant, like, Faith Mountain logo and just wear it on my head and speak this week. But... So today, I bring that up because, you know, I've been offended, you've been offended, and today we're going to talk about something that may offend you, something that Americans, we think we do, we think we're good at, but we're actually not so good at. And so the reason I want to talk about this and the reason we want to talk about this over the course of this series is that most Americans are not this. And we do not know how to do this. And the idea of talking about this sometimes offends us or triggers us. So here's a little trigger warning. I'm going to be talking about money today. And another little trigger warning. Some people are already leaving. No, just kidding. They're not. I'm going to tell you that God wants you to give away some of your money. So there you go. Here's the offensive stuff right at the front end, and you can kind of digest that as we talk. So over the course of this series, we want to teach you how to be generous. We want you to really learn how to be generous, not just how to give. I think a lot of us know how to give. We know how to give to causes. We see them all the time. You know, I go through Taco Bell like at least 6 times a day, and there's a little donation box where you can give to something, a kid to go to college or something. We know how to give. Anyone has been like sold giving, right? And that may be why you're so offended when we talk about giving at church, because you've always been sold giving. Like, hey, here's a poor starving kid, give. And we can... We know how to get you, we know how to make you give. You know, a guy with a microphone and a sad song and a poor kid on screen, and we can get you to give. And so maybe that's part of the reason you're so offended when we talk about giving. So this is not that. We don't want you just to give. We want you to be generous people. And so generosity is more than a do. It's a be. We want you to be generous people, to live generous lifestyles, to really live out generosity in everything that you do. And so generosity is more than just random acts of giving. We all do that, right? We are all random acts givers. We can, you know, see someone and give to them, or see a cause and give to them, or, you know, sometimes we call our giving like buying 19 boxes of Girl Scout cookies. We call that giving when really, is it? So genuine generosity transcends inspiration and guilt. Genuine generosity transcends being guilted or inspired to give. Generosity is a way to live your life. But here's what I want you to know. Is like, honestly, I don't care about your money. Like, honestly, I don't care about my money. The way that we run our house is Anna gives me a $50 gift card, a little cash card every 2 weeks. And I know, like, most high schoolers have more allowance than I do. So I get a little allowance, and I spend it most of the time on fast food. I told you about my Taco Bell habit. So, so I have a little allowance card. I have no idea how much I make. Like, honestly, I have no idea how much money I make. I have no idea. Like, I know we're not in, like, debt. I know we have a home loan, but I know we're not in a lot of debt. I know that we pay bills, and that's about it. So I don't know how much I make. I don't care how much you make. I don't care where you give to or where you're designated your giving. But I believe that you give to the things that you're passionate about. And so here, if you go here, if you attend here and you're passionate about what we do here, then you believe we're making a difference, then you give here. If you don't, then you don't give here. And I'm okay with that. So here's what we know, and here's why we teach on money and generosity so often. About once a year, we try and do this generosity series, and here's why we talk about generosity so much, is that Jesus talks about generosity a ton. If you go to the New Testament and you just kind of flip through the Gospels, right? Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, the Gospels that are written accounting the life of Jesus, and you just kind of turn the pages, you'll notice, like, every other page, Jesus is talking about money. So Jesus talks about money a ton, like over and over and over again. And then the second reason that we talk about generosity so much is that generosity has to be taught because it's not natural. It's not normal. And I think you know this if you have kids or if you hang out with kids often or if you are a kid, you know that kids are selfish. You don't have to teach them how to be selfish. They're naturally selfish, right? We have a 20-month-old, and I don't have to teach her that her toys are hers. She knows that. She gets that. Everything in the house is hers, according to her. She is the princess. She gets it all, right? You don't have to teach kids how to share, but you have to teach kids how to be generous. And with Americans, it's not natural, but it's something that we value. We value generosity. I think we see this a lot with celebrities, right? We see celebrity foundations all over the place. That's why when you go to McDonald's, you can donate right there. That's why, like, almost every day you see some kind of pitch or some kind of promotion to get you to give. So with Americans, it's something we value, but it's not natural. But it can be cultural. And I think that we live in a culture where people love to give, where people like to give. And so we have this culture. And so that's why we have a little bit of tension when we talk about generosity in our country, because it's something we value, but it doesn't come natural. And if you want to know what's natural when it comes to generosity, crazy is natural. So we titled this series, Crazy Like Us. Crazy is natural when it comes to money in our country. Did you know that most Americans, so here's three facts about generosity. Most Americans spend more money than they make. Most Americans spend more money than you make. You probably know this. You're probably experiencing this right now. Most Americans spend more money than they make. I don't know how that's even possible. I don't know how that's even legal to spend more money than you make. I know right now, if I wanted to, I could go buy a car that would cost me like a billion years to pay off. I could do that, and I don't know how I can do that, but it's crazy. We say things like, I can have the things that I can't afford. It's going to take me like a million years to pay off our house, and you know, I can go and buy a car, and I can get in crazy amounts of debt that I know that I can never pay back. We can do that right now, and so this is what is natural. Crazy is natural. Americans spend more money than they make. The second one is most Americans pay interest on things that decrease in value the minute you take possession of them. This is crazy to me that we invest in these things that decrease in value the minute we take possession of them. So to illustrate this, I know it's a little confusing. I have a little visual up on the screen. So here the middle line is time. So the first line or the second dash there after time is the minute you take possession of it. The minute you take possession of it, the cost of it goes up and the value of it goes down. We think of things like cars and phones and technology like this. Most Americans pay interest on things that decrease in value the minute that you take possession of them. As soon as you own it, the value decreases and the amount you owe increases. That's crazy. The third thing is most Americans are insanely rich in comparison to the rest of the world. Did you know if you're in here today and you drove a car here, you're in the top 5% of the most wealthiest people in the world? Give yourself a round of applause. No, don't. You are incredibly rich if you're an American. Do you know 21,000 people will die today because they're hungry? 21,000 people will die today because they don't have enough food. 4 children die every minute because of hunger or hunger-related illnesses. So while we have been talking, while I've been up here, 40 children have died because they're hungry. Just in the past 2 days, 110 people have died in a region of Somalia because there is no food or water due to a drought in this region. Meanwhile, I'm checking in on Facebook on an $800 iPhone. Americans are insanely rich compared to the rest of the world. Experts say to provide food, water, and basic health for everyone on the planet, it would cost around $20 billion, which is the exact same amount that Americans spend on ice cream every year. And the truth is, here's the crazy part, is that we know. We know. This isn't news to you that people are dying because they're hungry. This isn't news. We know that people are hungry and people are starving to death. We know. But here's the crazy part. I love ice cream more. We live in a culture that says that these things are normal. Some of you would actually say these things are needed. This isn't normal. This is crazy. And so here's what we're going to talk about today is that we don't feel rich, but we are. And we feel generous, but we aren't. And so I just want to, so we talked about three truths about crazy generosity and the way that Americans use their money. Now I want to talk about four myths about generosity. The first one is that generosity is spontaneous. That generosity is spontaneous. That if you go to a fundraiser, you go to a school thing, you give because somebody convinces you to give. But here's the thing about generous people is that generous people are not emotional givers. Generous people are not emotional givers. Generous people are planners. Generous people are strategic what they give to and when they give to them. So generous people are not spontaneous. Generous people are planners. The second one is that generosity is determined by cash flow. And this may be you, and you may be here today and saying, well, yeah, I understand this. I can't give because, you know, I haven't got paid yet. You know, it's the first of the month, but I don't get paid until the end of the month. And so I can be generous today because I just got paid. But generous people are consistently generous. If you say, like, I give when I can afford it, and I don't give when I can't afford it, chances are is you are a giver, but you're not really generous. So generosity is determined by cash flow. That's the second myth. The third myth is that it's the amount that counts. It's the amount that counts. You probably heard this a million times, right? Like somebody gives like a huge check to some organization. You say, wow, that was just such a generous gift. They're just so generous. I can't believe they gave that much. But here's the reality is that nobody knows that that gift was generous except the person that gave it. It may be a lot of money compared to what I make, but we are fooling ourselves if we think that we are generous because the amount of money. So it's the amount that counts. That's the third myth. Everyone can be generous and everyone can make a generous donation. Here's the fourth one, and maybe you think this as well, is that rich people are generous. We think rich people are generous. Most of us think, when I become rich, I will become generous. Most people think that rich people are generous because you give a lot or you are able to give a lot, that you can be generous. But this is the truth, is that rich people are rich and generous people are generous. Rich people are rich and generous people are generous. And I just really want you to get that, so say that with me. Rich people are rich and generous people are generous. So teenagers, if you're a teenager or like a young adult in here today, if you're not generous now, chances are when you get rich, you'll just be a rich person who's not generous. So there's no correlation between being rich and being generous. Everyone can learn to be generous. So that's what we want to talk about over the course of this series. And so we borrowed some ideas from this series from a guy named Andy Stanley. He runs a huge church in Georgia. And so we took this definition from him. It's certainly something we wouldn't make up on our own because it's clunky and it's kind of intentionally clunky because we want to be intentional about every word that is used here. So here's a definition of generosity from Andy Stanley that we're going to use over the next few weeks in this series. So generosity is the premeditated. You think about where it's going to go before you make it go there. Calculated. You know how much you're going to give. designated. You know where it's going. You know where it's going to go. Emancipation, and this is my favorite word, and this is what we're going to kind of camp out on today. Emancipation, that you set it free. You let it go. There are no strings attached of personal financial assets. And so here's our bottom line for today. If you want to write something down or kind of memorize something, here's our bottom line for today is when you free your money, you free yourself from your money. When you free your money, you free yourself from your money. And so here's fortunately for us, we are not the first group in history to ever worry about these things or to ever struggle with these things. Men and women in the first century shared our struggle. A crowd of people, they gather around Jesus. And we see this in Matthew 5. And so Jesus has this crowd, and he's Jesus. So what does he do? He says, hey, I'm going to preach to these people. And so Jesus delivers what we call the greatest sermon ever given. It's called the Sermon on the Mount. And so crowds are here with people, and Jesus decides to talk to them about money. So in Matthew chapter 6, this is what Jesus says. He says, no one can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to the one and despise the other. Therefore, you cannot serve God and money. You cannot serve both God and money. Jesus is making the two mutually exclusive. So you cannot serve both God and money. And here's what it boils down to. Either you are making your life, you're making God your treasure, or you're angling to make money your treasure in everything you do. So either in your life you're angling to make God your treasure, or you're angling to make money your treasure in everything that you do. And I know what some of you are thinking. You know, Jesus isn't talking about me. I'm not rich. I don't have a lot of money. You know, I'm in this place where I'm going to go to the grocery store tonight, and I'm going to look at toilet paper, and I'm going to look at macaroni and cheese, and I'm going to make a pros con list on which one to buy because I can't afford both. Maybe you're in that place where you're like, Mitch, this is great that you're talking about money, but I have none. I have no money. Maybe you're in that place where you're weighing the benefits over toilet paper over eating. Maybe you're in that place. I get that place. But it's almost as if Jesus knew that you would bring that up. It's almost as if Jesus knew that's what you would say. And so he then drops this powerful line. He says, you can't serve both God and money, but then he serves it with, I tell you, do not be anxious about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body or what you put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing? He says, therefore, do not be anxious, saying, what shall we eat or what shall we drink or what shall we wear? So here's why you need to be freed from your money, whether rich or poor, middle class, lower class, upper middle class, wherever you are, rich or poor, you're thinking about the same thing. You're thinking about money. You are a slave to your money. And so I want you to free yourself from your money, because whether you're worried about setting your kids up for financial success, or you're worried about putting food on the dinner table tonight, you're both worried about the same thing. And so as Americans, this is what we do. We get caught up in comparing our stuff to other people's. We get caught up in comparing my stuff with other people's. I get caught up comparing my house and my yard and my toys and my car to other people's. And so for me, I get caught up in comparing technology and shoes. That's my thing. I like nice shoes and I like cool technology. For me, that's it. So for you, it may be cars and houses, or maybe a 401k and a savings account. And so we get caught up in comparing our stuff to other people, and we want to elevate ourselves over other people. But here's what happens, is that it's a dangerous thing that when we start to think that our world is the world, and that everyone who has nice cars or fast cars or more savings account is in a better place than we are. And so we get caught up, and we get trapped in this dangerous cycle of comparing ourselves and comparing our wealth and our things and the way we look and what we wear to other people. And so I just want to tell you today, if you're in that place where you're like, I need this to make myself look better or to be better or to do something better, I want to tell you today that money can't give you what your heart is hoping it will. Your money can't give you what your heart is hoping it will. Your heart is hoping for one thing. And listen, to seek to be independent, to seek your, to set yourself up for financial success, to pay off debt, to live for financially free is a great Christian duty. To set your kids up for financial success is a great Christian duty. But to fall in love with things, to fall in love with money, is one of the most dangerous sins that we could ever commit. Because we seek creature comforts, we seek comfort of the world over only the comfort that Jesus can give us. And so Jesus' application is the same to those who have money and to those who don't, is that you need to be free from your money. Whether you're worried about stacking it up and buying fast cars, or you're worried about putting food on the table, he says both of you are anxious about the same thing. And so today we want to talk about, what does freedom look like? How do you become a generous person? How do you free yourself from your money? What does freedom look like? And it's crazy in America because we do things so crazy. Like we do things so backwards. We, you know, I see like 18 to 22-year-olds who are doing insane things for the Lord, like going across the country for the Lord because they love Jesus and they want to make Jesus known and they want to make a difference, so they get outside of their comfort zone and they go and they do these awesome things. But the older we get, the safer we play it. Now, you know, I got a wife, and I got a kid, and I got a second kid on the way, and I got a house, and you know, I got a car, and I get more and more comfortable. Life just becomes more and more safe. But when you read the Bible, like when you open it up and you read the stories of men who do great things, men who are doing awesome things, men who are just living godly lives and like in touch with what God wants, you see that the men and the women who do great things for God are never comfortable. So we get caught up in this. And the older I get, the more and more I have to lose, the harder it is to risk it all. Have you ever been in that place where you like you talk to just young people? I talk to young people so often who are just so desperate for like an older person to come along and mentor them, to show them that somebody is actually living this out. And so they're asking like, hey, Mitch, could you find somebody to just show me how to live this Christian life? They just want somebody who's actually living it out, who's actually risking it all. I can point them to good people, point them to nice people, point them to people who know their Bible. But who is actually living by faith? We get it so backwards because the older and older we get, the more and more aggressive we should be about the kingdom and getting rid of stuff and like transferring like knowledge and wealth to the next generation. But I meet so many elderly people who are just living so backwards. They're stacking up stuff. Like, why are you buying more stuff? Do you not realize that like heaven is so close for you? And I think the next generation is so hungry for that generation, for the next generation to invest in them. And so Jesus, he says two things about money. He says two things about money in Luke 18 and 19. And so he's talking about money, but then he also says two things about salvation. And so this is where I want to spend the rest of our time today, both while talking about money. One is about a guy who was a slave to money, and the other is about a man who was set free from money. And so the first story is seen in Luke chapter 18. There's this guy, he's called the rich young ruler. And so he comes up to Jesus, and he says, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Maybe you know the story, maybe not. So he comes up to Jesus and says, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And so each of us, like, we're digging in at this point. Like, what is he going to say? Like, what is Jesus going to say? And the first thing he says is just awesome. He says, "Well, why do you call me good? Who is good but God alone?" And so immediately, like Jesus, like, equates himself with God. He says, "Understand right now that you are talking to God. I'm not just a good teacher. I'm God." So he says, okay, you've heard it said in the Old Testament, right? Like, keep the commandments. like, honor your father and mother, you know, put no other gods before me. And so this guy's like, yes, Jesus, like, I've kept them all since I was young, since I was a lad. I've kept all these commandments. And at this point, Jesus is like, okay, smart guy, here's what I want you to do, is I want you to sell all that you have and give it to the poor, and then come and follow me. At this point, the man walks away sad. He's actually the only guy who ever came to Jesus who left in worse condition than when he came. So this guy leaves sad because his pursuit of God is finally choked out by his comfort of money. He thought he could do something to earn eternal life. And at this point, Jesus says, oh, it's so hard for these people. It's so hard for these rich people. It's so hard for these rich people to understand salvation because they're so comfortable. He said, it would be easier for me to take this camel over here and jam it through the eye of this needle than for the rich to understand this because they're just so comfortable. The disciples then say, well, like, they're confused too. The disciples who like spent years with Jesus, they're with him and they're like, well then who can go to heaven? Who can go to heaven? And this is the famous thing that Jesus says here. He says, what is impossible with man is possible with God. And Jesus is just so clear about salvation in this passage. And just to boil down why he came in a couple words, he basically says only God is perfect. And his standard for obtaining eternal life, or obtaining salvation, is perfection. That is why nobody can obtain eternal life by works, that we need Jesus. And that's why he came. And the Bible says over and over that our real problem is that every one of us is trying to build our identity on someone other than Jesus, something besides Jesus. And so this man leaves sad. And then what's awesome is that the next chapter, Jesus is introduced to another rich man. It actually says, then he ran into a man named Zacchaeus, and the words are, who was very wealthy, who was very rich. And so this man named Zacchaeus comes, and the first thing we learn about him is that he's small, he's tiny. And so he's trying to, like, come to Jesus and see Jesus because Jesus is doing all these awesome things, right? He's healing people. Like there's a man with a withered hand who he just like makes his hand come back to life. And he's like, yeah, I want to see that. And so Zacchaeus, he says he's very little. And so he can't see Jesus. So he climbs a tree, which is super intuitive. Like I'm going to climb this tree to see Jesus. And so he's there sitting in the tree and Jesus and his entourage come through. And what's amazing is that Jesus notices him. And he knows him. He says, Zacchaeus, get out of that tree. I'm going to have dinner with you tonight. I'm going to go to your house, and you're going to give me dinner. And so they're at dinner, and Zacchaeus is just like, hey, Jesus, like, I understand. Like, I've been doing things wrong. He was a rich tax collector, which in that culture would have been like the chief of sinners, like, because the tax collectors, the way that they made their income was by ripping off people. The government said, hey, you need to collect this amount, and then anything on top of that, you had your living. So by him being a rich tax collector meant, like, he ripped off a lot of people. And so he comes and he says, hey, Jesus, I'm going to give half of what I have to the poor. I'm going to give half of what I have to the poor. And on top of that, if I ripped you off, I'm going to give you four times what I ripped you off for. And so then Jesus says the second famous thing. He says, for the Son of Man came to seek and save the lost, the guilty, the slaves. Zacchaeus didn't walk away sad. He acted. He understood that godly sorrow leads to repentance. He understood who exactly Jesus was. And the important thing for us to know is that a lot of us and a lot of the crowds in the New Testament, they came to Jesus to get things from Jesus. But what we see about the disciples is that disciples come to Jesus for Jesus. Crowds come to Jesus to get things from Jesus. Disciples come to Jesus for Jesus. And I don't know what your religious experience is. I don't know what your Christian experience is. I don't know if somebody dragged you here to church today, but I understand that this is the summary of the whole New Testament, is that crowds come to Jesus to get things from Jesus. And maybe you've come to Jesus to get things from Jesus. But disciples come to Jesus for Jesus. And so why is this concept of salvation so tied to money? Maybe it's because Jesus knew that it is hard for us to let go of something that we're so comfortable with, even though it's the very thing that will bring us death. In Exodus, we see this story, right, of the Israelites, and they're slaves. They're slaves to Egypt. And so Egypt is just like running their lives, and the Israelites are just like in so much pain. And we see that in the first couple chapters of Exodus. And so God says, hey, I want to free these people. And I'm going to free these people through this guy, Moses, this flawed guy named Moses. In like the previous chapter, he like just killed someone. And so I'm going to use this flawed guy, Moses, and I'm gonna free these people. And so you know the story, right? Like there's like plagues. Like God sends these plagues, and it's like plague after plague. And then they're like gross, like people's skins falling off. And then the final plague is the Passover, where like God sends his angel and like kills all the babies in Egypt. And so there's this plague. And then they come out to the sea, and God splits the sea, and they walk through it, and then crashes the sea over the Egyptians. And so here are the Israelites, and they're looking back at like all these awesome things that have happened. And then God says, hey, I'm going to provide a pillar of cloud and a pillar of fire for you to follow me. And so there's like this pillar of cloud, this pillar of fire, and they're supposed to follow God. And then God says, hey, I'm going to rain down food from you from heaven, that you will have daily bread because of me. And so here's everything provided. Like they see the past, they see the future, they're provided for daily, and yet they still go back to that comfort. They complain over and over. Like, why did you take us from Egypt? Like, we were okay being in slavery there. We were okay being slaves there. Like, what is it about us that we keep going back to slavery? And so what I want for you is that I want you to be free from your money. And the way you do that is you free your money. So if you're in a place of plenty, maybe you're like Zacchaeus. Maybe you're at a place where you just need to give like half of your stuff away. Maybe you're in a place of need, and maybe you need to free yourself from the guilt and the anxiety that money brings. So what would it look like for you to be free from your money? If you do not have the freedom to give your money away, it's because something other than Jesus Christ is your functional Lord and Savior. Jesus says you will hate the one and love the other. I think when you think about the radical generosity of Jesus Christ, you'll understand freedom. When you see him dying because you were the treasure of his heart, you'll understand and you'll make him the treasure of yours. So I want you to not sit down with a calculator to figure out how much money to give away. I want you to sit down with his word at the foot of the cross and see what he wants from you. See what you need to free. I love the freedom of being able to give my money away. The freedom to say that things and debt and comfort, they don't own me. And I know the impact that others' generosity has had on me. And so I want to go ahead and I want you to imagine for a second. And this is what I want you to imagine. Imagine that you had a checking account full of all the money that you wasted over the past 5 years. You may be young in here, 15, 16, and you're like, okay, like let's add up all these Taco Bell runs and like let's add up. So you define wasted, right? So what is that? What is all the money that you've wasted over the past 5 years? Like maybe you bought something and you immediately like, I shouldn't have bought that. I know for me, as soon as I turned 18, I got a credit card because it was cool and it was the early 2000s and you could do that. And so I got a credit card and I had like a $500 limit. It was a starter credit card. And so what I did is I went and bought a DJ kit because I wanted to be a DJ. I thought it was cool. I was DJ M. And so I wanted to spin the ones and twos because it was cool. And so I went and bought like this DJ kit and like I wasted it. I probably used it like 3 times because it was hard. Like DJing is hard. I couldn't do it. I wasn't that cool. And so you define wasted. What have you wasted? Maybe you bought a boat. Like people told you not to buy a boat and you bought a boat and it's now a bad idea. It's just sitting there. And so you define wasted. So you have all this money over the past 5 years in a checking account. This money that you wasted, it's in a checking account. But here's the thing. saying you can't spend it. You can't spend it. You have to give it away. So all the money that you've wasted over the past 5 years, you put in a checking account, you can't spend it, you have to give it away, and you have to give it away in the next 12 months. And so for most of you, it's hundreds of dollars. For some of us, it's thousands of dollars that we've wasted. Imagine you had that checking account. And so you go, and there are things like the school's having a fundraiser, and they need $800, and you're just able to like write a check, whoever does that, for $900, and you're like, hey, that's cool. And they're like, hey, are you rich? You're like, no. Like, my youth pastor did this thing, and all of a sudden I have all this money I wasted in this checking account. And so what would you do? What would your attitude be toward that money? I mean, imagine how much fun that would be to be able to just write a check and just be generous. Imagine what that would look like. Imagine how freeing that would be. You wouldn't be possessive, like, because you wouldn't be able to pay bills or debts. You would experience the joy of a generous life. So here's my question. Why don't we do that now? I want you to live this kind of free life, because it's not just a money issue. It's a heart issue. So what would your life look like if you lived like that? What would our community look like if everyone in this room lived like that? What would our church look like? And so you don't have to do this. You don't have to do this. If you're anything like my students, you don't listen to half the things I asked you to do anyway. So what would it look like? I'm not telling you to do this. I don't want anything from you. Our culture has taught us how to get things from you. Sad music, Sarah McLachlan, dogs. Like, we can get money from you. We know how to do that. Anyone with a microphone can get money from you. But what I want from you, what I want for you, is I want you to be freed from slavery. I want you to be freed from money. I want you to free yourself from your money. So what if for the rest of your life you were really living a generous, free life? Because for the rest of your life, people are going to try to get you to give money. They're trying to sell you on giving. And that's maybe why you cringe when we talk about it anyway. So I want you to come back in this series, Crazy Like Us. And in this series, we're gonna teach you how to do this in the next 2 weeks, how to live a generous life, because we want you to live the kind of crazy, outrageous, backwards lives that the gospel and that the Bible want from us. So I want you, don't miss next week. So right now we're gonna transition. I figure like this is a great message to have an offering, and we do that every week anyway. So we're gonna go ahead and we're gonna take an offering. And so during this time, I just want to talk about the impact of generosity on my own life. And this is not to guilt you to give, but it's really just like how did I end up here? And so growing up, my family, we didn't have a lot of money. I remember we would spend weekends at food banks that churches did, and we would go. And I remember we didn't have toilet paper or food, and so we would go to food banks, and they would provide us food for the next week. And I remember my parents couldn't afford Christmas presents, and so they would call up some churches, and churches would provide us Christmas presents and all of that, and other people's generosity. And I never, like, the amazing thing about these churches, like, they never wanted anything from us. Like, they just gave to us. And in that, like, I got a positive perception of the church. I had a negative perception of this church, but how can you have a negative perception when these churches are literally buying you Christmas presents? And so church gave me a positive perception of what was happening. I started getting involved in this church, and I wanted to do things that other kids were able to do. I wanted to go to camp. I wanted to learn more about Jesus. I wanted to go on mission trips, and we couldn't afford them because, you know, we went on a mission trip to Mexico. It was almost $2,000, and the church was able to scholarship me so I could go. And it was at that mission trip where I felt the call from God on my life to preach the gospel, to study the word, to teach the word. And it was at those camps where people taught me about a Jesus who was there for me in my darkest days. And then, you know, I felt called to ministry, but I couldn't afford college. And so other people's generosity and scholarships was able to pay for me to go to college where I was equipped to do his ministry. And so maybe you think like, oh, you know, my generosity turns on the lights. I want to encourage you that it's way more than that. It's way better than that. So if the ushers would come down and pass the baskets, like, understand that your generosity makes an impact because it made an impact on me. It made an impact on my life. I can genuinely say I would not be here today if it wasn't for people's random generosity. Their generosity that said, hey, I just want to love people. I don't know who they are, but I want to love them. So what does that generosity look like in your life? I just want to go ahead and pray as the band comes up, and then we'll transition to something else. Father, we are just so thankful for your cross and what you did on that cross 2,000 years ago, that you did the only selfless act in all of human history, and because of that, we can be selfless as well. God, right now, if there's somebody who's tied to the comforts of this life, who's tied to money, who is a slave to money, I pray right now that in their hearts, they can just turn from that. They can turn toward you. They can love you deeper and better. And God, we love you. We thank you so much for the generosity of these people here who enable us to do ministry, who enable us to reach this community. And I pray that your gospel and your truth go far beyond these walls. Because we pray this in the precious, powerful name of Jesus. Amen.